The next talk is going to be around the power of email and effective digital communications, which flows off nicely around the omni-channel strategy and the different ways that you need to really engage with your clients now. So Ross Sibbald is the Commercial Director at Striata Marketing Solutions. He's got quite a history in the marketing space, having even led many of the young students that moved into marketing careers from the Durban University of Technology, various private colleges and business schools, heading up an IMM franchise, which is quite cool. And then he joined Striata and he was there for a while, heading up email marketing, left to go work at ABSA for a bit as a head of digital commercialize, where he focused on the various commercialize teams with the goal of increasing the bank's digitally active consumer base, increasing the online sales via digital channels and driving revenue opportunities, and then moved back in 2015 to Striata to head up the newly formed digital communications agency. And I think just talking to some of the themes that have come through today around how we're moving towards a more digital client base, it'll be very interesting to see what Ross has to say.
Steps, how many guys have tripped on those steps? Right, awesome. Hi, everybody. Great to see everybody here today. Thanks very much for the introduction. Didn't realize it was that long. So cool. It's nice to be here. I'm really passionate about all things digital and more especially around email. So the presentation is going to be slightly skewed there, but yeah, so more especially around email, the design and the creation of email. We can maybe just leave that there for the guys who are online. The design and creation of email and how we can implement email into your vast arsenal of communication tactics, but then ultimately how we can use email to generate a return on investment. Okay, and we'll define that return on investment a little bit later. I've been involved in email communications for about 15 years now and helping many of South Africa's leading blue chip companies implement their email comms. And what I've definitely noticed is a more progressive movement towards data science and digital comms, all right? And of digital comms is a whole big sphere. And just this earlier presentation by Perry, there's quite a lot of stuff that he spoke around in data. I'm also going to talk about data, but I can highlight certain things now and not go too in depth. And maybe that can just save us a bit of time as well. So let me just put a quick stopwatch on. Because there's a lot of similarity. So for those of you who were concentrating around that, you'll see exactly how it fits in here. We need data in order to make sort of informed decisions going forward. I think we all can accept that. And then the final thing for me when I speak at a conference, this is not my first rodeo, or if you guys are attending, I'm sure it's not your first conference you've attended, you probably come for two reasons. So whether you're here physically, or the guys are online, or the people are gonna watch the recording a little bit later, I think there's probably two things you come for. One is to validate what you already know, all right, and sort of hear other people speak about it and go, oh, cool, I'm actually on the right track, or I'm doing the right stuff here. And when I was hesitating, you know, maybe I shouldn't be, I should be confident in what I'm doing. That's probably one side of it. The other side of attending a conference is probably, well, is hopefully to learn something new. And if I can just give one little nugget today and you walk away with one little cool piece of info, then in my mind, I've done a good job. Those are just my feelings. I'm happy to take questions at any stage. I'm not sure what the protocol is, but if you've got a question while I'm busy talking, please shout it out and let's deal with it then and there. Otherwise, we can take it at the end or I'll go home. You've got one more talk. I'm going for a beer after this. So when I was thinking about this conference or thinking about the presentation, I was looking at some of the other topics that were put together as well. There were a lot of I don't want to call them random thoughts, but a lot of random thoughts that were coming through my mind. And these are some themes that have probably been discussed already today and or will be discussed tomorrow and is in your everyday work environment. I mean, there's some big ones here, right? Big data. I mean, it's in big bold letters because that's huge. We can't make any decisions without data. So let's not labor that point. Poppy, coming on the 1st of July, everyone's freaking out about it. I'm not going to speak on that at all because there's a big session tomorrow. I think it's your very first session deals with Poppy, but we need to be conscious of Poppy and the implications behind that. Omnichannel, we've just heard about omnichannel. It's a massive thing. There's a big difference between multi-channel and omnichannel. Multi-channel is just communicating across every channel. omnichannel is trying to create that seamless experience. And as customers move between channels, they get that same experience. So when I'm operating via an email onto your online platform through social media and then into your call center environment, they should know it's Ross, and this is where Ross is in terms of the journey. Email is certainly evolving. I'm going to spend quite a bit of time on that because that's where my passion is, so forgive me on that. I am going to be skewed into one thing, but hey, we're allowed to, right? So I can have my strong opinions on email, and welcome to challenge me on that. And then I think the key one here is we have more data than ever before. All of us sitting in this room now are exposed to more data than we've ever had ever before. But are we using this data correctly? Are we using this data to the best advantage? And I think that is a key factor. So like, how do we get this data? How do we store data? How do we retrieve data? And then what do we use that data for going down the line? So this is pretty much the agenda without having an agenda heading, right? But if we start looking at the data and its purpose, there's five sort of themes that I'd like to look at, right? So what is your goal and what is it that you are trying to achieve? Then let's agree to use data. And I think it came through very clearly in the preceding presentation, right? The power of data. Then let's decide what type of data we need to collect and how we're gonna use and where we get that data from and how we're gonna use it. Then let's tailor the right message, because each one of us here will react differently to a message. Some of us might react to a stick, some of us might react to a carrot, right? So let's tailor that message correctly, and we use the data for that. And then let's try and identify which is the best channel that we can use. No guesses for knowing which one I'm gonna be focused on, but there's lots of channels that we can certainly use. So the power of the data, that pretty much rests in your hands, guys. It rests in your ability to interpret this data and use it the right way. It's as simple as that, really. It was said a little bit earlier, in order to make a strategic decision, in order to make an informed decision, you need to have reliable data, up-to-date data. So we all know about that. Why is data important? If we have the wrong data, we're going to be making the wrong decisions, right? Simple as that. To me, in a nutshell, data helps us with informed decisions. I mean, I know I've already said that, but I think it's worth repeating. Data is also important to help us create subsets or different target markets. We all know that customers react differently to different messages. You can have, I like to use the terminology, a good debt and bad debt, right? So good debt, we don't want to penalize that person forever. Let's just help them get back on track. Bad debt, we kind of go on a different path. I just want to throw a disclaimer at you, though. I am not a debt management expert. Okay, I'm not a data scientist or a data modeler, all right? But what I am passionate about is trying to take data and leverage that into effective communication. So without sounding arrogant or whatever, I like to believe I'm a communication specialist, all right? But in order to be successful in that side of things, I've got to have good data, right? And I can rely on other people to give me that good data. I mean, I think that's fair, right? Cool. Data collection. So we've been collecting databases and building up databases forever. Think about yourselves. I mean, I've had the same cell phone number now for 26 years. Think about how many girls' numbers I've been collecting all these years every time I go out, right? I'm building up my own database, okay? Make sure I keep that cell phone number so I don't lose my database. Lots of ways of building a database. I mean, not all of us have the privilege of working for a big bank or a big insurer where they've got Oracle and Adobe and SAP or whatever, and they're spending tens, 20s, 50s of millions to help build that data. Some of us can also just work on a spreadsheet, right? A spreadsheet is also a way of being able to manage data. So, you know, don't worry about that side of things, and you'll be surprised anyway. I mean, no disrespect to the banks, please, I take this with all the respect that I say it, but all the banks are my clients, and you'll be surprised how bad their data is. Okay, so Perry's mate, they couldn't pronounce their name. So my name's Ross, right? I get lots of phone calls where people call me Roth. And I just go like, whose mother would name their kid Roth anyway, you know? So it's Ross, right? How difficult is that, you know? And then I also get called Rose. So lots of people address me by a female side of things as well, for female gender. So I get it, I get that frustration. So we need to have up-to-date data, right? We need to have the quality, the right types of data. Talking to Raina just now in terms of, he's got lots of email addresses that are invalid. I mean, think about people moving around companies. You know, we don't all stay at the same company, so we move around. So our email address has become invalid and I forgot to update whichever company. And so there's a big trend in this country at the moment, I digress a little bit, but actually worldwide, where people are no longer giving work addresses when they're asked to fill in, they're actually giving their personal addresses, right? Because that stays with you forever. So for me, absolutely, my bank, my insurer, anyone who looks after my millions and all my investments in that, personal address, right? So that I know that I've always got stuff on record. Okay, but a little bit of digression. So that's data collection. So just trying to keep things simple, trying to keep things a bit practical. What type of data do we need? We obviously need to start collecting personal details, you know, spell the person's name right. Obviously, there's fat finger problems often, but personal details, let's get the person's email address, let's get a cell phone number, all those sort of things. I mean, these are the basics. Think about demographics, geographics, psychographics. I mean, if you can get all that sort of information on a form and your customer's willing to give that, then why not? Let's start looking at those segmentation variables. Let's start analyzing past buying behavior. Think about macro. There's only one reason macro is such a successful store. It's not because they've got wide merchandise. It's because they were one of the first companies in South Africa, certainly, to introduce the macro card. You had to have that card with your unique number to whenever you made a purchase. So they know Ross purchased a case of Hansa at Woodmead. Ross purchased another case of Hansa. Ross purchased, bloody hell, this guy just drinks a lot of beer, right? He's a bit of an alky. But they can track it. Every Friday he comes into my shop and buys a case of beers. Wow, what kind of weekend does he have? But they're starting to build up information about me, right? And that's really, really important. It's out there. Start getting it, buying behavior. Think about loyalty programs in that. Every time you swipe your card, you catch a train, you go to gym, you redeem something, they're collecting data on you. No point collecting it unless you're going to use it. Okay, so that's quite important. The where and the how, I quite like this because I think millennials, they get a bit of a bum rap. A lot of people go, millennials, you know, but millennials have actually changed the way we get data because millennials and social media have been a score for us. Think about Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Telegram, all those things. People willingly give their info out on social media. And that spawned all of us now to actually go, well, hang on a second, I can give my information out. I'm not that scared to give my information out, provided that you use this data in the correct way. The moment you renege on this contract, all right, and my data gets breached or it's lost, like last year with Experian and Liberty and that, then the trust is broken. But until then, I think we have got trust. Collecting data at point of sale, at events, at surveys, customer actions, we've spoken about that. I mean, it's huge. Lots of companies at the moment are doing surveys. Take Woolies right now. The reward, the 50,000 Rand a week for the next 4 weeks just to update your details. That's all. Just update your details. You can stand a chance to win 50 grand because data is gold, right? And all they're doing is sending out a simple email, click, go to a survey, and you answer 5 things, all right? That's the importance of data. So just a quick summary, the whole thing around that. In terms of big data, it's complicated. Everyone's striving for big data. Big data, content management, customer experience, these are the big trends right now. But as we know, big data is large, complex data sets, all right? It's collected from a variety of places or sources. But the idea is it provides us with better predictability for buying behavior and then ultimately return on investment. But for me, the big opportunity is CLM, which is customer lifecycle management and automated triggers. So that is key, right? So as any customer takes out a contract, however you define contract with the brand, i.e. you take out a cell phone contract, you take out an insurance policy, a credit card policy, you sign up to a gym, whatever it is, you're gonna enter on a journey. All right, so let's start building a relationship with that customer. You can't build a relationship in silence, right? And that's teeing up the whole idea of email, really, okay? So when a person joins or takes out this contract, let's start feeding them the right information. Let's welcome them. Let's let them know when they're going to be making payments. Give them information, educate them. Let's rather build a relationship with our customer first before we just start trying to get money from them, okay? So that's an important fact for me. With the cell phone provider that I belong to, I've been with them for 26 years, I get one communication a month, and that's telling me I owe them money, okay? Where else? You've never thanked me for being a customer. I've been with you for 26 years. That's a ton of money you're making off me. Not once have you said thanks. So the moment they do something wrong, I haven't in 26 years as it turns out, but remember my number's out there with all those nightclubs, so I can't afford to move. But you know, if the moment something goes wrong, if I'm not emotionally attached, I'll bail. If I am emotionally attached because they've built a relationship and trust, I'll remain. Are we comfortable so far? Sweet. Okay, so I think unlocking the power of data, it's pretty much up to you guys. The data is available. How you analyze it and interpret it is up to you. And my only thing I can really suggest is let's start now. Okay. Sorry. Cool. So I wonder how many people have gone through this scenario, some of your customers and maybe even yourself. I mean, it's happened to me before. You get a bill, you have to make a payment, but you're busy packing for your holiday. Maybe it's your honeymoon or a big holiday that you've been planning. And so you go away onto this holiday and you're drinking mojitos on the beach and whatever it is and stuff like that. And you're away for a month and then you come back to, in the olden days, your postbox filled with letters of demand or your inbox filled with emails, right? And automatically creates that negative feeling and that resentment. Okay, so we need to try and overcome that. All right, so what data can we use? Remember, there could be good debt customers and bad debt customers. Are you comfortable with that as a scenario? Okay, cool. Got to be able to understand that. And then also, when do we speak politely and when do we demand? All right, when the poor guy's been away for a month or he's been away on holiday, he's just forgotten to pay you. He's not malicious. He's still got money in his account. He'll get to it. Don't stress. So treat that customer differently from someone who it's the 50th time now that they haven't made that payment. So, coming into the communication side of it. So there's two key themes. One is the data and now the comms. So in terms of the digital communication mix, there's lots of elements. And the Perry earlier spoke around omni-channel. This is all part of it, all right? There's lots of these things that you can use. Each one of these mediums or channels has their pros and their cons. There's no doubt about it. I don't think you should use any one in isolation of the other. That would be crazy. You couldn't survive just doing TV advertising. You couldn't survive just advertising in a newspaper. All right, you've got to use a combination. So, you know, an integrated marketing or an integrated communications mix is a good way of thinking about things. And those are in no particular order. They're actually just in an alphabetical order. But like SMS in this country has absolutely blown through the roof, all right? It's picked up so much in the last few years. And South Africa is so far ahead of the world in terms of SMS comms. I was on an hour strategy call with our owner, our new owner in Canada, in America, where SMS is a they don't even know what it is. And they can't believe how powerful a strategy SMS can be. Whereas here in South Africa, it's commonplace. So there's a lot of good things that we do here that we think we're a third world country. No, forget about that. We actually do a lot of good stuff in this country. Okay, so there's tons of things to be thinking around there. The most important element to factor in is you can't use one in isolation of the other. Try and have it as part of your overall mix. This is quite an important slide. I've still got 20 minutes, so I'm on track. Okay, hopefully you're still all engaged. The communication equation is something we talk about a lot at work because we're in the communication game. And it's quite a nice concept here where and I'm going to spend a little bit of time on this, right? Manufactured experiences equals engagement, equals behavior change, equals ROI. But let's start with engagement. I think that's the key thing here. So customer engagement unlocks everything. Okay, customer engagement unlocks everything. If I can get my customer engaged with me as a brand, right? I can build trust. I can build loyalty. I can get the customer engaged. I have a higher propensity of them remaining loyal as opposed to defecting, right? So we get the customer engaged. By getting them engaged, I can influence or change their behavior. Take it from negative behavior into positive behavior. That's what we're looking for. As a result of influencing behavior, we can achieve a return on investment. Return on investment is not always profit, right? It can be profit, it can be your bottom line, it can be lowering costs, it can be decreasing your bad debt, increasing your good debt, for example. Okay, there's lots of ways of interpreting ROI. But how to achieve those things actually goes to the very first point here, manufactured experiences. And that's where like my responsibility would kick in, for example. We must manufacture the experience for the customer. Okay, so creating an event, you know, going to an event and there's promo guys and girls and there's smoke being played and there's the right band and cocktail. cocktails, you are manufacturing an experience, right? So when the customer walks out of there, they remember that night and they talk to their friends about it. Think about cigarette advertising, all right? You can't do that anymore. So they went underground. And if you guys, I mean, I certainly remember going to some underground, I don't smoke, but I went to those parties, right? And it was about the experience. And then they ended at about 10 o'clock. So what did you do? You went out now. And then what, you spoke about it. And that's how the cigarette brands got their brands circulating, right? Because you went to this underground party. They manufactured an experience. So how can you do that with comms? Sending the right comm at the right time helps manufacture an experience. So when a customer takes out a credit card or takes out a cell phone contract, the moment they walk out of that door, or they're doing it online now, probably, the moment that happens, they get a welcome mail. Hey, Ross, welcome to MTN. Hey, Ross, welcome to Standard Bank's credit card division. Thanks for taking out this contract. And then you get a series of mails, you know, day one, day three, day seven, as an example. You don't put all the info in one communication. It's info overload, right? So we're manufacturing this experience. When it's their birthday, they get a birthday message. When it's their anniversary, they get an anniversary message. So you manufacture the experience. Why? To get engagement. Engagement influences behavior. Behavior that's being influenced results in a return on investment or loyalty. Are we comfortable with that as a concept? And so what I like to do personally is when I'm talking or consulting or working or whatever it is, I try and take every comms strategy and link it back to this equation. And if we can successfully link it back to this equation, I feel we're on a good step or a good path. If we can't, then we must adjust and learn. And I think that's a fair principle to follow. Happy? All right, happy days. Cool, so the power of email. And I've got 16 minutes to really nail what I'm most passionate about, right? Is the power of email. Now, what's really powerful about email is this has the ability to nurture and target prospects. Turn these prospects into customers, turn these customers into repeat customers. As a result, a repeat customer gives you a loyal customer, all right? So that's really, really a cool factor to be thinking about. A lot of things that come up, and when I'm chatting, and certainly when I go to anywhere and talk to anybody, even my mates around a bra, and they go, oh, Ross, you know, you work in email. The first thing I say is, actually, I don't. I work in digital communications, right? Email is just one of them, although I really flip and like email, don't get me wrong, okay? So it's a key play for me. And they'll go, but email is dying, and email is dead, and that sort of stuff. You know, apps have killed email, for example. It couldn't be further from the truth, okay? Email's been around now, I think, for 42 years. I think this is the 42nd year, right? So it stood the test of time. That's one of the biggest tests, is time. It stood that around. WhatsApp, it's dying, right? Telegram's about to kick WhatsApp dying. So everyone thought WhatsApp was the schniz. Not so much anymore, all right? So email, 42 years. I just want to throw that perler out there again, okay? Apps have actually done email a massive favor. So think about Facebook, think about WhatsApp. I mean, WhatsApp is an app, right? It's done email a favor. Because when I started using email, when I first started work, 1996, I think, was my very first like official job. What did I use? And I got an email address. I mean, it was about this long as well. I'll never forget that. But I got my first email address. What did I used to do? I mean, I was like 21 years old. I used to mail my mates. Hey, let's go out for drinks tonight. You would probably forward a couple of dirty pictures and stuff like that to your certain buddies. And you'd send those. Remember those, like, if you don't send this to 10 people, you're going to get bad luck chain mail thing. That's what we used email for, right? But that would clutter up your inbox. That's all gone. That's all gone. When was the last time you actually wrote an email personally to your friend, to your family? Yeah, I bet you, yeah, there's a lot of head shaking, which I'm glad about, thank goodness, that you'd nod and go, just today. I can't remember the last time I actually wrote an email to a buddy. What do? You use WhatsApp. You've got family chats on WhatsApp. Like all of us, I'm sure my family's scattered all over the world, right? So how do we keep in touch? Via WhatsApp, all right? Family chats. I message my mates, let's go for drinks tonight. Now I afford the dirty pictures via WhatsApp. You know what I mean? I don't use email anymore. So what's happened now? It's allowed the email channel to get back to its original purpose, communication between a brand and its customer. So it's had a rebirth as a result of apps. So apps haven't killed email. Apps have been the third life, or whatever the right phrase is. Okay. Then obviously you can't not talk about it. The pandemic has helped email. In fact, the pandemic has helped digital. All right. It's probably leapfrogged companies by 5 years. Oh, that's not the right expression. It's probably made companies work 5 years ahead of where they actually are. Digital transformation. And we've all heard about that, right? I mean, our company is 130 people. We all started working remotely within 1 day. And I'm sure you've all got similar stories amongst yourselves and your mates. You know, how the whole company, we all went into the office, suddenly we're all working remotely, and it's not bad. A few hiccups, but we're getting there. All right. So the pandemic has done wonders for my industry that I work in, right? I've never been busier than now. I mean, how many of us, I mean, I'm proud that we're here today, right? I mean, I didn't want to speak online. I'm glad you guys are sitting here. I much prefer seeing some nodding and frowning and stuff like that. But we're the exception, I think. You know, when was the last time you went into a bank? Okay, we got to go to the shops, but other things like that. I mean, I haven't bought any clothes for ages. I don't want to even walk into those shops anymore if your paranoia kicks in, right? So the digital world has been accelerated, okay? Helps communication. So I just want to take you through a few things to just really prove my point for any of you who are still skeptical about if email is important or powerful or not. And the one thing I want to show you is why email is powerful through stats. Now I know, what is that phrase? Stats, lies, and statistics or something like that, right? Of course, you can go into the internet and download lots of stats and then just find the ones that suit your narrative. Of course we can do that, and I probably did do that. But there are some cool things to be thinking about here, all right? Email is the number one activity on a mobile device. Okay, number one activity on a mobile device. When you buy your phone, there is actually only one app that is already preloaded, and that's your email app. All the other apps you have to go and fetch, okay? WhatsApp, Facebook, doesn't come preloaded. Okay, that's just something to think about. But email is number one activity on mobile. 85% of people say that mobile devices are a central part of everyday life. And guys, this is pre-COVID. This is 2018, these stats, okay? So it's more than 85% now. It has to be, all right? 55% of all emails are opened on a mobile device first, then on a laptop. Now that, or desktop. The importance behind that is, remember I said I'm really passionate about design as well. So you need to design for mobile. If your email looks terrible on mobile, they'll just delete it and they won't go and even bother looking at it on their laptop or desktop. I mean, I was watching you guys in the earlier session and a lot of you were on your phones. I get it, right? We can all multitask. We've got to, you know, there's emails that you got to answer, right? That's what you were doing. You're on your emails. maybe you're on WhatsApp, but most of you are probably on your email. I mean, definitely on the laptop there, checking out email, which is fine. Or you're making amazing notes. So that's cool. Awesome. I love it. Love it. Now I've thrown myself off point. Oh yeah. Opened on mobile first. So we've got to design for mobile. All right. And that's not a foreign concept. Always design for mobile. Okay. There's that concept of always on. I mean, we've all heard of that, right? It's always on. What's the first thing you do when you wake up? You grab your phone. What's the first thing you do? You check your email. What's the last thing you do before you go to bed? You check your email. What do you do when you're stuck in traffic? Okay, you shouldn't be checking email. You shouldn't be looking at your phone, but you probably do, all right? Or especially if you're not driving. When you're waiting for an appointment or something like that, you're checking email. Sure, you might go onto Facebook or Twitter and stuff like that, but the chances are you're looking at email, right? That's power right there. Some other cool things, some other stats to show you why email. So what I'm trying to get to here is, guys, if email is not part of your strategy to collect debt, it should be. Okay, that's what I'm trying to get to, right? There's about over 4 billion email users last year, all right? By 2023, that's only 2 years away, there'll be just under 4.5 billion. That's half the world's population will be on email. That's a massive, massive channel. Gmail, which is the world's biggest one, has over 1 billion active users. Right? Gmail is massive in this country. I would say with my clients, particularly the banks, at least 60%, a minimum of 60% of their database is a Gmail address, okay? Which is power, all right? Some other cool things here, just to blow your mind. During 2020, there were about 300 billion emails sent every day. I don't know how much that is times 365, okay? There's too many zeros there. But that's a lot of email. All right, there's tons of email going. Yeah, some of it is spam. Of course, there's spam and there's the Viagra mails and there's the Nigerian guys. And yeah, I get all of that, right? The scams with the 401 scams. Of course, there's that sort of stuff, right? Look, email is there's an art and a science to using email in your strategy, right? You can't just go, we're going to do email now. You'll fail. This is not a sales pitch or a plug or anything, but you've got to consult experts if you're going to incorporate email into your strategy and get the right art and science into the whole aspect of things, okay? Some other cool, so that your email gets into the inbox, right? And not into the spam folder, as an example. And then once it's in the inbox, making sure it gets read. But that's a whole nother presentation or a whole nother conference, okay? We don't have time for that today. Email, you can receive it on all devices. So whether you open it on your smartphone, on your laptop, iPad, no, that's not right, tablet rather, could be an iPad or your cell phone, all right? Be surprised. Everyone goes, South Africa's a third world country. Not everyone has an email address. Bollocks. Almost everyone in this country has an email address because almost everyone in this, I'm not talking kids, right? Oh, even kids have, is on Facebook or Twitter, all right? In order to be on Facebook and Twitter, you have to have an email address. In order to be on many apps, you have to have an email address. So when you, your company or your colleagues say, South Africa doesn't have many email addresses, go, no, we as a business just don't have them yet. There's a big difference, right? So if we go to the data collection side of things, please always try and collect an email address. And then if you've got a well-trained call center or front of desk person, always try and push them to ask for a personal email address and not a work email address, because that address stays with them forever. Okay, just little things to think about. It's so subtle, but it can save you tons of agony for years and years to come. There are no downloads, I've spoken about that one already, or apps to receive an email, and this is quite staggering. People between the ages of 18 and 24, so what is that, generation after millennials, next or whatever it is, check their mobile on average 74 times a day, all right? And remember, what is opened on, emails are opened on a mobile device first, all right? And then the other stats, 25 to 34, 50 times a day, myself, okay, I'm a little bit older than 44, 35 times a day. I'm sure I check mine more than 35 times a day. There's no doubt about it. You can see how you're doing on yours. So what are we looking at? Yes, there is social media. I'm not saying there isn't. Yes, there is research via social media. I mean, I do that, right? I get a hot offer in an email, all right? Buy these running shoes. I mean, I was looking at yours now because I want to get the Ultra Boost, right? I want to get those ones. But what's the first thing I do when I get an email from Adidas around it? I'll go and research about it. What are the peer comments? Okay, so the email is driving me to a landing page, driving me to a website. And there starts happening your omni-channel concept. The same principles apply in all aspects of communication, whether it's debt or trying to make money through marketing offers. Cool, are we happy? No one disagreeing yet. Or are you saving them up? Okay. The power of email and creating the right customer experience. Okay, this is key. I'm sure you've heard about customer experience, user experience, digital experience. There's so many experiences out there right now, but it's true, all right? But we can use email to help, remember we spoke earlier, manufacture that experience, all right? So when a person takes out a contract, welcome them, send them an email, congratulate them, get them on board, go through a nursery strategy, giving them the right information, send them a survey, you know, 1 month into it via email or SMS, whatever their channel may be, all right? But email is a powerhouse right now. Gone are the days where you got a plain text email, right? There's HTML, there's imagery, there's GIFs, there's moving parts in an email now, there's video in an email, there's tons that can be done. And it's such an affordable channel as well, all right? Which is key, so that helps with your bottom line. The other aspect is it helps in lowering costs and speeding up payment. No disrespect to a call center, and I'm sure, and there's tons of positivity around using a call center. Of course there is. But imagine sending out an email, all right, and having a pay from within an email, all right? So we have that technology is available, all right? So you can receive an email and, hi Ross, you owe us 5,000 Rand, please pay off 1,000 Rand in installments or pay it all now and get a 5% discount. Whatever the offer is, because remember, we've looked at the data. We can see Ross isn't a bad guy. This is his first time and he's been with us for 30 years. So, you know, let's talk to him nicely versus the exact opposite extreme, okay? We send out that mail. Let's say that mail costs, whatever, 10 cents to send out that email and Ross pays his 5 grand and clears his debt from within that email. I mean, think about your return on investment on that versus a call center. You know, my first thoughts are the cost of a call center, the infrastructure, the seats, the bums on seats, the timing. When do you call? You know, don't call me during the day. I'm working. Don't call me in the evening. I was going to say I'm drinking, but I'm not. I'm exercising. Don't call me. You know, do you know what I mean? Like, when do you call someone? And then there's laws about when you can and can't call. It's difficult. And then I hear it's someone who's chasing me for money. I just put the phone down, right? It's because it's embarrassing. Debt could be a bit of a stigma. And I don't want people to know that I've got debt. But if I get it via email, it's faceless, all right? So it's a much more affordable channel. And of course, it can speed up payment as well. Versus, I don't know, does anybody actually send out paper anymore? I don't think so, hey? Like debt collection notices or something like that. Can you imagine taking it to the post office and eventually when the customer gets it? I mean, their debt's probably tripled because they're several months behind again, you know what I mean? So those days are just gone. This is just some stuff that we did this with a UK company, and we actually won an award for it, which was pretty cool because we helped revolutionize the debt collecting agency. But those two stats are not as a result of the case study. That's some research that's done. But they found that, so remember in the first world, though, they still send, the post still works, right? If I post something today, you'll get it tomorrow. But they find if you can digitize the collection notices, that early delinquency, the people paying is up by 12%. That's huge. And then late delinquency is about 30%. So there's the return straight away. And depending on your number and your volume, 12% can be incredibly significant. And then 30% is three times more. That is even more significant. Okay, so that's pretty cool. And then there's some underlying benefits. You know, you save on paper, printing, postage, the speed to the customer. You know, if I click, boom, send, the customer's got the email now, right? They may not open it now, but it's already in the inbox. You can get faster payments. It reduces days outstanding, which is critical in everyone's world. It avoids using a third party or collection agency's fees, right? You get all the money. You're not having to share it with them. And of course, it improves your bottom line. For me, this is probably one of the most important elements around why email is so powerful. And it's the power of real time, all right? So real time probably doesn't exist. We should actually use the phrase near real time. Because there's like a second or two until we get the data from a bank or from something like that before we can fire it off. So near real time. But let's think about what this is. Automation, right? Automated triggers based on an event. So that's what I like to think about. Customer life cycle based on a customer event. So in my mind, what is good about having a series of communications running? It's one is to influence your behavior change. We spoke about this now. And then to acknowledge the behavior change. All right, so think about it in your own experiences. If you belong to a loyalty program, you're currently on blue status, but need to get to gold status. Hi, Ross, you only need one more gym visit to get to gold, all right? Oh, flip, I get more perks if I get onto gold. So what do? I rush out to gym that night, boom, I get to gold. Hey, Ross, congrats, you've now moved to gold status because you've reach the right limit, right number of going to gym visits, right? So what has that done? It's influenced my behavior change and then acknowledged it. The chances of me opening that mail, the acknowledgement mail, is sky high because I want to see if I have achieved it or not, which gives you the opportunity to cross-sell and upsell other sort of elements. Okay, I've got 2 minutes left. Is that okay? Cool. So we're comfortable around that, okay? So that's what I mean by based on a customer event. It's relevant, we can use it to create segments, and of course, we can tailor our messaging. Just a very simple journey here. I am being simplistic here, so forgive me for that, but just to get the point across, we can email the bill. Then of course, let's send out a pre-due date reminder, right? Hey Ross, don't forget, boom, boom. Then perhaps a first overdue, a second overdue, and then, hey, thanks for making that payment. So there's 1, 2, 3, there's 5 emails there that cost you 50 cents. I'm just saying 10 cents a mail, right? 50 cents to ensure that you've got money in the bank. I think that is 50 cents incredibly well spent, okay? Just some little points there, and I am being a little bit cocky. If you can't write, then don't, okay? So in other words, how do you word it? You know, don't be too aggressive, don't be too soft. Be polite, be professional. Use factual and short subject lines. Don't be threatening. Try and get payments from within an email. My last slide, actually second to last slide, the power of email, it's measurable, trackable. Everything is measurable and trackable. This email was delivered to Ross. Boom. Ross opened this email at 3:05. Ross clicked on this link, and this link. Ross made a payment. Everything is measurable and trackable, and especially if you're wanting to build up evidence to go to court and stuff like that. I gave Ross's notice. He got it. There it is, time and date stamped by the email platform. In fact, he opened it and he clicked on these things. He is aware of his debt, right? Whereas if I drop a notice off in your post office, post box, who knows, right? No one knows. Cool. So my only last takeout, just to keep on time, email remains a key channel for effective comms in the debt world. Cool. Happy days. I'm not sure if anyone has any questions or wants to argue against anything, or is just going, cool, maybe I've taken one little nugget out of this and then I'm chuffed.
I think there's one question.
Yes.
So I think in terms of, you know, the name list for collections, I agree. You know, whether it's statements, you send email, or you send the SMS. You know, while you were speaking, I was just trying to reflect. And when last did I ever send an SMS, or most people? Sure. You don't really send SMSs, but we're pushing the SMS.
Yes.
You know, if I had to look at it, yeah, almost probably 10, 20 times I'll use WhatsApp.
Yes.
As a shorthand. But, you know, in terms of the push and the pull, I'm trying to get through, you know, your comment was quite interesting. WhatsApp is dying, but SMS is still alive.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to figure out, you know, is there stats to prove that or,
sure.
You know.
Is that, okay, happy, that's a great question. And WhatsApp is well, let's try and deal with it in two things, SMS and WhatsApp. In terms of SMS, I agree with you. I haven't sent an SMS personally 10 years. Yet every year when I renew my contract, I get, I don't know, what do you get? Like 100 free SMSs a month. Like, cool, thanks, you know. But in your lower LSMs, SMSs are still powerful as a communication channel because you don't need data, right? So you can send that SMS to each other. In terms of pushing information out, SMS becomes a very powerful channel because your reach is great and everyone has a cell phone number. Yes, some people are multi-SIMmed, but that's fine, right? So from that perspective, WhatsApp is slightly different because as a business, you can't push the comment. It's actually a servicing channel. The customer has to initiate the conversation. So in the debt world, no customer is going to initiate a conversation through WhatsApp. And that's how it has to be done. You can't technically you can, but legally you're not allowed to push communication via WhatsApp. Okay. Happy? Okay, cool. Yeah.
Hi.
Great. Cool, man. Glad you enjoyed it.
Question. WhatsApp versus Telegram. There was that spurt of take up on Telegram.
Yes.
What's your take on the future of those two pieces? VHS and Vita.
Yeah. It's a great, and I was thinking a similar analogy. The answer is going to sound terrible because I don't know. There was a lot of hype around WhatsApp and pushing you that notification saying, please consent to our new security laws, and you've got until whatever that date was. The fact is they've been doing that for over 2 years or well over a year already. They just hadn't notified anybody. So all of us were already consenting to their stuff without even knowing it. Then suddenly there was a bit of a panic going, oh, Poppy and sharing data. Oh, I'm not going to do this, so therefore I'm going to go to Telegram. Okay. In my circle, I do not know a single person on Telegram. Do you? I mean, I'm asking, like, I don't know anyone on Telegram. Sure, my circle's not massive, you know, but five good mates kind of thing. But, you know, when you go out, no one said to me, hey, can you reach me via Telegram? So I'm not sure if that's sort of answering your question. In my personal opinion, I believe WhatsApp will remain for a long time still. Maybe they'll buy Telegram and squash them. I don't know. I think that hype of the legal side of things, in my opinion, was just hype. And people have settled back into, I'm just so used to using WhatsApp. I've got all these group chats set up already. Why should I leave? In my opinion.
Okay, we have a couple of questions online.
Perfect.
Let me quickly.
Must I look there? Maybe.
Okay. All right. I think it's from the question for end of presentation. On the point of SMS as a communication channel, would you say South Africans have reached some level of SMS fatigue, i.e. marketing SMSs get ignored? If so, any thoughts on strategies to address it?
Yeah, that's a great question. I believe, yes, in terms of marketing, SMSs has reached fatigue and has reached saturation point. I firmly believe that. But SMS is still a good channel for operational type communications, for notification type communications. I'm trying to think at the top of my head. You order a new couch, all right? They send you an SMS going, your couch will be delivered tomorrow. Please be there between 9 and 10. Okay. Then at 8:30, they send you a reminder SMS, and so on and so on. I think we get the journey there. I think everybody is going to react to those sort of SMSs, no problem. But then when you get an SMS, I got one this morning from Old Mutual saying, please take out some insurance. And then I got one from an insurance company going, you qualify for 200,000 Rand personal loan. I got that yesterday. Yes, I ignore those as well. So I agree. I think SMS via, marketing via SMS has hit saturation, but operational and notification based is still a big play. In my opinion.
Okay,
that's
cool.
Like a cap disclaimer.
The other one's, any idea what percentage of emails get directed to the spam folder, and are there any strategies to minimize this?
So two-part question. No, I have no idea the percentage of emails that go to spam. It's a lot. If you're not using a communication expert company, all right? So this is not about Striata. I work for Striata. We're a 22-year-old business, and we focus on digital comms, of which email is a big part of our business. So there's a lot of science into how you get your email into an inbox. So just if you can bear with me. So let's just say, and I'm going to use APSA because I work there, right? So Striata is going to send email out on behalf of APSA to a customer. When that email arrives at your Gmail address, in a gazillionth of a second, Gmail's going to go, hang on a second, there's an email coming from at Striata domain, Striata environment, but it says it's on behalf of APSA, and do I let this into the inbox or does it go into the spam? In that gazillionth of a second, it looks for the certain science elements, the things we've put into play that allows and gives us permission to send that email on their behalf. Boom, it goes into the inbox, okay? And it doesn't go into spam. So that's the science. When I spoke about earlier, the art and the science of design, that's the science part, okay? But there was a second part. It's kind of answered both, I think.
And then there's one more that kind of follows on that from Debbie, saying, how do we improve not being blocked by Gmail or business emails if used for collection?
So I think maybe I can take it a step left of that. Let's not let our customer get into debt. Let's build that relationship with our customer from the very beginning, all right? Nurture them, guide them, manufacture that experience, make your brand a trusted brand in their eyes so that they actually want to pay you. Get Debbie check in place, get a debit order in place, build that trust, build that loyalty, send comms at the right time. I think that can go a long way. So that you actually don't get to that step of, damn it, I have to send out that aggressive notification now, and then the customer potentially blocks you. But do you have control of them blocking you? No, you don't. If they want to block you, they can block you. Yeah.
Cool. Anything else? Great. Thanks so much, Ross.
Cool. Thanks, everybody. Enjoy the rest of your conference.